I'm feeling great. I'm feeling we're here. I'm feeling like we have we've done what we set out to do, and particularly for Tai Tokerau and Tāmaki. So we're here and we're ready. So you might record Awari's pebble in the shoe story. So now there's a bunch of pebbles. It's nearly like a pebble bed.
That was new Te Pāti Māori MP Maria Meno Kapakengi speaking to us on Friday, just minutes after the release of the special votes, which of course showed the party picking up an additional 2 seats from the preliminary election night results. Willie Jackson is a senior member of Labour's Māori caucus. Kia ora, good morning.
Morena, Jack.
What happened in the Māori seats?
Well, first of all, congratulations to them. I think it was a fantastic result for them. And their strategy of concentrating on young people has certainly come off in terms of the electorate votes. I know these people, some of them are my friends and relations, unfortunately. And, you've got to celebrate for them. You know, at the same time, I'm disappointed for our crew. But we lost 6 electorate seats. We might get one of them back. But I think what a lot of people are missing is that we got just under 85,000 votes in terms of the party vote, Jack. So that shows our people are strategic. So I congratulate Te Pāti Māori, but I congratulate our people too, because I think they went for the 2-for-1.
You can't put it all down to strategic voting, right?
Well, I think there's a lot of that in what they've done. I mean, because from when I was on the campaign, people were saying, we're voting for you, we're just not voting for your candidate. And so many times we're going to support so many of the initiatives that Labour has rolled out. I mean, people are proud of some of the stuff that we did. You know, increased funding for Matatini, $1 billion a year. I mean, you don't get 85,000 votes for your party vote if you haven't done a reasonably good job.
So what does it say in Hauraki Waikato, for example?
It says, well done to young Hana, and that Nanaia has done a...
But Nanaia's not on the list, right? If your theory is that everyone was strategic voting...
Well, not everyone, I think if you look at the vote, you tell me where that's replicated in the mainstream areas where if the electorate MP wins the seat, 99 times out of 100, they win the party vote. That's not the case here. In every case, Te Pāti Māori MP lost the party vote. And I think you've got to give our people a bit of credit in terms of, you're right, in terms of Tainui and Hauraki. But I think some of our people might have thought Nanaia was on the list. They might have thought that. But it's very, very
So they're
close.
Smart enough to be strategic in some electorates.
We're not everywhere.
But in the Hauraki Waikato, they're not switched on enough to realise that Nanaia
wasn't
on the list.
I wouldn't say they weren't switched on enough, but I think that it's
But
not,
I mean, the strategic voting is quite clever, right?
Do you think it's strategic voting? Do you see what happened in the Māori?
I don't have a view on it at all. Well, you're the expert, huh?
But you don't see that type of voting replicated. You know, 85,000 votes for the party vote for Labour, 58,000 for Te Pāti Māori. I mean, it's unprecedented and unheard of. So we weren't decimated. I need you to talk to Mikey about this.
It was interesting.
We were a bit broken about it all.
Are you not?
Well, of course we're disappointed.
Yeah.
Of course we're disappointed. You know that there's some wonderful electorate MPs who lost their seats, but the Māori caucus is not decimated. All those MPs are back
except for
your wonderful
Nanaia Mahuta.
Apart from Nanaia.
Yeah, one of the most experienced Māori MPs in New Zealand. Te Pāti Māori performed really strongly in the special vote count. So take Tektai Tokerau, for example. They went from about 500 behind on the preliminary results to about 500 ahead on the final results. So that indicates that a lot of first-time voters enrolled and voted on the day. Why were Te Pāti Māori able to mobilise voters in that way and you perhaps weren't?
Well, I think they brought all their resources to the table. I think that John Tamahere was driving it from the back. He had all his organisations in on top of it. And good on them.
What was the first thing JT said to you after 2 o'clock on Friday?
You owe me a couple of $1,000 because we had a few bets. But he doesn't know how to count properly, JT. So we're actually all squares at the moment. But, hey, look, well done to him. You know, I'm really proud of him, believe it or not, because of the way they went from zero to where they are now. And I think the challenge is, and I think what our people are saying, they're saying we want you two to work together. John's saying the same thing too. Look, we always have a few jokes. But this is Māori seats are volatile. You know, we've had, you know, your good mate Winston, I'm looking forward to that return interview, Jack. We had Winston winning the Māori seats in 96, lost them all in 99. They can come back at the drop of a hat, so it's volatile. But what I think our people are saying is we want Te Pāti Māori and Labour Māori to work together.
Why didn't Meka Whaitiri win?
Well, you have to have a look at the case. I mean, our people have been strategic. I don't want to dump on Meka's whānau or anything now. I mean, they've been close to me through the years, and I think you need to ask people down Ngāti Pro and Kahunganu. But, you know, as strategic as they were across the different seats, people down that area are not silly. They made their own choices. And we've got a wonderful candidate in terms of Kushla. Mm. I want a mihi to Meka for her time, for her history. It's a shame we never got together to work things out. Maybe one day we will.
If it's in the interest of... You still haven't talked to her?
No, we still haven't talked, no. But anyway, one day...
Not at all.
One day... Oh, I think we said kia ora to each other once and she did a waiata for me at one of our hui. But look, hey, we'll work through that. I want to wish her all the best. You know, she served Labour well. She served our people well. Mm. It didn't work out for her. It was the wrong choice, in my view, from her and Te Pāti Māori. But, hey, they made a lot of other good choices and well done to them and well done to her for her time.
If it is in the interest of Māori voters to strategically vote so that you bring in more MPs for Te Pāti Māori, you increase the size of Parliament in this case, you have an overhang, does that mean that in future elections it's not in the interests of Labour's Māori MPs to contest those electorates?
Well, I mean, I think you were on to me about this last time, weren't you, Jack? I think you and Tamahere were sort of coming up with some sort of strategy.
No,
I'm... Yeah, I'm sure you were, because he was sounding very similar to you, or you were sounding very similar to him. I think that the result demands that we look at the future together. I think you can't just say, "Oh well, let's not contest the seats," because otherwise you're dumping on
but
those.
What does that mean? What is looking at the future together?
Here's the thing: is how do we find it? How do we best utilise MMP? Right? I think that's the question, isn't it? Because here's the other side of it: if we had got 32% Labour, Te Pāti Māori got 6 seats. You know the numbers. We would have been in the conversation to be a government.
Long way from 32% though.
5%. 5%.
Yeah.
We're 5% away. What I'm saying is that if that's going to be the scenario in the future, will we be talking about an accommodation type strategy? I'm very wary of that because I know how...
But are you open to that is what you're saying?
I'm open to the conversation. But when you've got Penny Henare who loses the seat by 4 votes, it's not like those seats couldn't come back at the drop of a hat. That one may well come back. Yeah. We may well win all the seats back. But I think our people are saying we want you to work together and the result demands that you have courted or going forward. And JT and I have already talked about that anyway.
So on election night, Materia Tude was really critical of your handling of Hepuapu. Do you hear her comments?
No, but some of my family did and I think they emailed her and they weren't particularly happy with it. So I hope I'm summarising her correctly.
No, that's all right. So basically, she said she felt that your handling of Hepuapua had contributed to a situation where opposition politicians and voters were accusing the government of a secret Māori agenda, of a conspiracy of sorts. Do you accept that criticism?
No, I don't. I think she's talking nonsense. And I want to have a kōrero with her one day because I didn't realise she felt so strongly about it because I saw her the next day. We were very friendly. I never saw anything. We had a cup of tea. But let me tell you, I wasn't the person handling Te Pūapua. It was Nanaia Mahuta who handled it, did a good job. I sort of got the aftermath and had the sort of one-off comments that sent Winston, into ecstasy. You know?
I just wonder, with the benefit of hindsight, when you reflect upon the last two terms in government, did Labor's failure to articulate and advocate for its Māori policies fuel the rise of other parties, do you think?
I think we gave them some ammunition.
How do you think you gave them ammunition?
By not being, if I'm being honest, and I think even the Prime Minister said this, and you see that in a number of hui, that we should have been a bit clearer earlier on about what, you know, the kōrero around co-governance. And I certainly was, so was Nanaia. Jacinda was early on. And I think
do you think being clearer entails?
Just so people can understand where we're coming from, that it's not a Māori takeover, that they're safe. And I think
that was the point that everyone made. Sorry to interrupt you, but, it was interesting to me when the original proposal for Three Waters came out and we had the governance structure where Māori representatives made up 50% of those boards. It was really interesting going into interviews with senior Labour MPs and asking them questions and saying, is representation for Māori and non-Māori as a percentage of the population exactly even on these boards? And you would never get a straight answer. You'd always get ducking and weaving and people refusing to answer and changing the subject.
I think your point about us being Could we have been clearer? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I think we've admitted that, and that's what... But when Kieran McInulty and Chris Hipkins, the Prime Minister at the time, explained all of this, didn't it quell everything? Didn't everything go quiet after that? Because most New Zealand people, most Pākehā people, they don't mind those sort of setups. I know Seymour tries to make out it's something coming out of South Africa. But nothing could be further
from
the
truth. Was that too late, though?
Well, that was probably 12 months ago, wasn't it? You know?
A bit less than.
But off the top of my head. No, I don't know if it... Look,
but, was the opposition to Three Waters so great by that stage and had fueled so much opposition that actually it was very difficult to put the genie back in the bottle?
Well, I'm glad they did what they did. I'm glad they gave the response and the answer there. And in my view, it quelled everything. And in my view, despite what Seymour keeps saying, I don't believe that co-governance and this Māori takeover played any part in terms of us losing the election. And if you go around everywhere, all good. Most Kiwis, they got no problems in terms of partnership. They got no problems in terms of co-governance. Seymour and them are just talking it up, and that's why he ended up with half the vote that he originally started out with. He was 15%.
How do you think negotiations are going
to go? Well, it's going to be interesting, isn't it? You know, it's fascinating watching David and Seymour and... Christopher Luxon, you know, all of a sudden they're showing Winston all the greatest respect. I mean, the way they ran him down. Well, not so much the incoming Prime Minister. David Seymour didn't want a bar of him, didn't want to know nothing about him. He had billboards. I had billboards over my place, my apartment in Wellington. I used to walk home every night and see Seymour talking about rubbishing Winston. Hasn't it turned around? And who's the most powerful person in New Zealand politics at the moment? The person who you... got stuck into and was very disrespectful to on this program, you know. I don't know if he'll ever come back.
You?
No, Winston. But I mean, after that interview with him, so it shows you, Jack. Doesn't matter how much you decimated someone in these shows, they seem to rise and go to bigger heights afterwards.
Do you think Chris Hipkins will stay on as leader?
Well, I hope he does.
He has your support.
I've been clear about that. I know I upset other party members, the odd individuals, by being very clear. I was clear going into caucus. I'll be clear right now. I think he could be a great opposition leader. You know, he's got the fire. He's got the passion. You know, you watch him and the way he cleaned old the incoming Prime Minister up, Luxon up in the last debate. Brilliant. And I think he'll do that in the
House.
Do
you reckon anyone will challenge him?
I don't know. That's up to the caucus. You're trying to get me to break the rules again. People already get irritated with me being so frank and clear about things. But if they do, good luck to them. But Chippy's got my support.
What about you? Are you committed to staying for this full term?
Well, you know, again, I think I was clear that I was probably looking to leave after the election, but I've been sort of convinced by a number of people close to me and within the party to stay around. And I want to stay because... I want to stay because I'm nervous about what might be coming, you know, in terms of this nonsensical treaty referendum. Let me tell you now, Jack, if they try and push that through, you know, it'll be 81 Springbok tour, civil unrest, like, you know, times five, times ten.
Violence?
I hope not. One hopes not, but I've already heard... that's not something that Māori... have advocated, so certainly something that I'm not advocating, but I don't think we'd be able to manage it or control it when I hear from our people, come on, surely they're not going to do that after we used the system, after we went through the courts, after Māori mortgaged homes and their lives in terms of utilising the system, the English system, to got victories, and now all of a sudden they're going to change the rules. I don't think we'd be able to manage it in this country, and I hope that Mr. Luxon and Winston show a bit of common sense over this.
Thank you for your time. We appreciate it. Willie Jackson.